Hachette Audio presents Lightning Flowers, My Journey to Uncover the Cost of Saving a Life. Written and read by the author, that's me, Katherine E. Standefer. To the girl in the parking lot, here is the book you needed. In the name of which love should I act, and how should I act? In the name of which love should I sacrifice another love? Whom shall I love the most, and to whom do the most good? To my wife or to my children? To my wife and children or to my friends? How shall I serve a beloved country without doing injury to the love for my wife, children, and friends? Finally, to what extent can I occupy myself with my own affairs and yet be able to serve those I love? Leo Tolstoy, On Life. I can only answer the question, what am I to do, if I can answer the prior question of what story or stories do I find myself apart? Alistair MacIntyre, After Virtue. The knowledge of death is reflective and conceptual, and animals are spared it. They live and they disappear with the same thoughtlessness. A few minutes of fear, a few seconds of anguish, and it is over. But to live a whole lifetime with the fate of death haunting one's dreams and even the most sun-filled days, that's something else. Ernest Becker, The Denial of Death. For centuries, philosophy has taught that there are four causes. 1. The causa materialis, the material, the matter out of which, for example, a silver chalice is made. 2. The causa formalis, the form, the shape into which the material enters. 3. The causa finalis, the end. For example, the sacrificial rite in relation to which the chalice required is determined as to its form and matter. 4. The causa efficiens, which brings about the effect that is the finished actual chalice, in this instance, the silversmith. The four causes are the ways, all belonging at once to each other, of being responsible for something else. The three previously mentioned ways of being responsible owe thanks to the pondering of the silversmith for the that and the how of their coming into appearance and into play for the production of the sacrificial vessel. Martin Heidegger, The Question Concerning Technology. Prologue, Tucson, Arizona, 2012. Nothing can prepare you for what it feels like to be shocked by an implanted cardioverter defibrillator. Like a badly spliced film reel, my memory of the night is fractured. In one instant, a player on the other intramural soccer team had fallen and the game stopped. He was getting up, brushing his thighs. In the next, my hands became claws. A maul cracked open my chest with a sickening thump, a hot whip tearing through my back. Did somebody kick in my spine? And then I knew, and I was screaming. There's no way you wouldn't scream if you felt it, my sister had said. By then, the defibrillator had been in my body for 3 silent years, resting loyally above my left breast, keeping watch for the arrhythmia that could send me to the ground unconscious, with a heart quivering rather than pumping blood. Now, on a crisp November night in Tucson, Arizona, I dropped to my knees in time for the second shock. What if it doesn't stop? I knew something was wrong, either with my device or with my body, but probably my ICD. If it was an arrhythmia, I should have been collapsed, unconscious. Not sharp and alive like this, staring at the backs of houses at the edge of the field, their kitchen lights spilling dully out the windows as I screamed, "Call 911!" A third shock. "You can either scream or breathe," a voice inside me said, and I began to pull in air, cold, heavy breaths, the way I'd learned to breathe into pain in yoga. I am either alive or dead, and I choose which. The device did not fire again. Can I get someone behind me? I called out. I don't trust myself not to fall. Someone cupped my back immediately, supported me to the ground, and the sky came into view. A ring of faces, the sharp white field lights. The smell of burning, which was me. There is a kind of dream state that settles over the body in these moments, a clarity that rarely visits us when our lives are busy unfolding. For lying on my back, looking at the stars, a question lodged itself in my brain, a wild constellation of if-then statements. If the defibrillator just saved my life, if a defibrillator is just metal, if metal is mined earth, if children sometimes work in mines, if tunnels collapse, if warlords profit, if women are raped, if mountains are dismantled and made toxic, if mined earth just saved my life, was it worth it? The thin branched burns that uncoil from the heads and necks of lightning strike victims are sometimes called lightning flowers. Fern-like, following the patterns of rain or sweat, they are rose-colored lightning bolts frozen onto the body, as beautiful as they are terrible. I will never know what my insides looked like after 2,000 volts, if my tissue erupted into lightning flowers of the body cavity, a sudden bloom. What I do know is that the night I took 3 shocks to the heart, I was marked, called into the world in a way I could not turn away from. What can save us, I would learn, never comes without cost. Some people say lightning strikes cure blindness. This is my version. Part 1. The Revealing. Causa Finalis. Chapter 1. Boulder, Colorado, 2007. The first time my younger sister passed out, she was 18, just beginning her freshman year of college at the University of Colorado in Boulder. One hungover morning in her dorm room in the fall of 2007, her phone rang, and she muted the call. She was sliding the phone back underneath her pillow when she blacked out and tumbled off the bed. When she woke, everything was blurry, dreamlike, her fan loud and big as a train. Christine's roommate found her crumpled on the dorm room floor and raced for the resident assistant, who called 911. At the hospital, doctors checked her blood sugar, took a CT scan to look for epilepsy. Nothing was conclusive, so as the months ticked quietly on, football games and classes, mountain hikes and parties, her strange fall out of bed receded from view. Then in December, just days before finals, it happened again. This time her roommate's phone went off and she fell back into her pillow. When Christine came to, she called our parents in the Chicago suburbs, who began setting appointments for her over winter break. She would, after all, be home in just a few days. Instead, my sister, by then 19, spent those few days going into cardiac arrest over and over. First in the campus health center, then in the hospital, where a nurse noticed an abnormality in her heartbeat that pointed toward a dangerous genetic condition. The first time my parents received a call from a cardiologist named Dr. Samir Oza at Boulder Community Hospital, he told them he could not release their daughter until she had a cardioverter defibrillator implanted. Christine had a rare arrhythmia, he told them, one that seemed to be activating cardiac arrest when she was startled. She had been lucky so far. Her heart had restarted itself each time. But she might not be so lucky in the long term. My parents bought plane tickets. Meanwhile, my sister, surprised by a nurse in her doorway at the hospital, discovered the ceiling tile spinning and woke suddenly with paddles poised above her chest. I have been dead, she told me years later. Picture the sign posted on the door of her hospital room. Do not startle the patient. Speak softly. And my mother creeping into the room whispering, Christine, Christine. I don't remember getting the call that she was in the hospital, but I do remember crying for her. That winter, I lived in a one-room cabin on the property of a summer camp south of Jackson, Wyoming, 5 miles past the Hoback Junction, in a small valley rimmed by dark pine forests, where cliffs hung off the mountains like broken teeth. On the Broken Arrow Ranch, we had wood stoves, no cell service, and a bridge across the pale blue tongue of the Hoback River, which was slowly hardening into swaths of ice. The week my sister almost died in the Colorado foothills, we were deep in mud season up in Wyoming. Tree roots jutting up at angles out of the first paltry snowbanks, trails slippery with melt. We'd already had a freeze over Thanksgiving that left my toilet tank solid. It was the beginning of a life I'd dreamed of since childhood. I'd grown up in a suburb northwest of Chicago, not one of the leafy old towns along the lake with their grand brick estates and quaint downtowns, but a subdivision farther out, 45 minutes down the train line, where the trees were just gaining height, on land that had until the early 1960s been a tomato farm. All down my block, a few standard split-level and colonial houses repeated, each with different colored shutters and brick facades, their grass trimmed, flowers blooming in rows every spring. These were the years of expansion. These were the decades of sprawl. What had once been tall grass prairie edged by forest, with blue stems so dense the horizon wavered, now disappeared beneath strip malls and subdivisions, until my neighborhood was sentineled by big box stores and their vast parking lots. The concrete stretched most of the way to the Wisconsin border. And though I loved the way tornado winds blew off the plains into Chicagoland each May, ominous green-gray thunderheads crackling over the softball fields, these twists of wildness were rare. Most often, the uniformity settled over me like a stranglehold. The flat gray of the sky during Chicago's seemingly endless winter. The stifling humidity of summers that left the house sticky. All around me, I saw a place being plucked and prodded into form, the wild-growing plants weeded out. The deer that had once ghosted the scrap of wetland at the end of our street disappeared when more McMansions went in. Even as a child, despair filled me whenever I saw a sold sign on a wooded lot by the side of the road. I knew what came next, and I felt the loss in my very body. When my parents first brought the three of us girls out west, I was in preschool, and though I spent as much time throwing up from altitude sickness as I did strapped into my tiny plastic ski boots, something of the big white massifs, the unruly pale rivers, imprinted in me. At first, we went to Colorado every other year. By late elementary school, the trips were yearly, and each time the minivan turned east again, I found myself weeping, leaned over the back seat to watch the mountains recede. All that crisp sun, all those big views, the miles with nothing in sight but a ranch house or two. Afternoons spent in the company of deep snow and pine trees. I had found something there. The first year we drove through the Nebraska Panhandle.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.